Hi, NY.
Yeah!
And that's it. Thanks for having a lovely evening. That was great. Quick show of hands. Who's been with us at a Hi NY event before? Raise your hands if you're brand new.
Ooh.
Virgins.
My name is Michael Zaitsev. I have the distinct pleasure and privilege of organizing these events for New York's cannabis community. I want to thank you all deeply for coming out on a Monday night, beautiful weather, and taking the time to be here with us tonight. Give yourselves a round of applause.
Yeah.
This is a big week for cannabis and for drug policy. Everyone know about UnGuess?
Yeah.
You guys are so excited today. Everyone got a case of the Mondays, huh?
Case of the Munchies.
Oh, man. Mention the website. Which website is that? My website? Your website?
Do my both.
HighandWide.com, meetup.com/HighandWide. All the info is on that board right there. Just some quick housekeeping items and announcements before we get into the program. There have been some awesome events in the city the last few days and some more coming up this week and in the next few weeks. There's an awesome summit today at NYU's Cannabis Science and Policy Summit. Quick show of hands if you attended there. Excellent. How'd you guys like it? Did you learn a lot? There's an event tomorrow night. There's the NCIA Regional Caucus. If anyone's interested in attending, we have a 50% discount for Hi NY members. Come see me, I can give you the details. Wednesday is 4:20.
Party.
Really? You guys, come on.
Yeah.
What's going on tonight?
I think you must have smoked out.
It's Monday, wow, all right.
Last Monday meeting we're having.
4:20 is a special day, true or false?
True.
Who can tell me why?
Why?
Why? That's the day.
Please scan.
Can I tell you why?
Yeah.
Please.
That's the day my family came to America.
Oh.
25 years this time. Soviet Union. We'll talk later. No. All right. Where's Annie? Annie and Christina. Here you go. The Cannabis World Congress and Business Expo coming to Javits Center this June. We have a great deal for the Hi NY community. Ladies, stand up real quick.
Yes.
Do you have any questions? Do you guys want to tell them real quick about the deal, or should they just come see you after?
Well, we have flyers. We have attendee informational brochures at the front.
Front table
for awesome. So we got some flyers up front.
Yes, they have business cards for myself. I've run the show.
Mike.
I mentioned Sensi's party on the 4:20. She's been with us forever. We are having the show in June. June 15th is the add-on workshops day. June 16 and 17 are exhibits and full conference. And we worked out with Michael, we're High in New York members, a great deal.
And we also
exhibiting at our show.
Yes.
And he's going to be doing, he's actually going to be the lead off, I think, for our exhibitor product theater, which is new to our show, promoting his new book. And
they don't know about it.
Oh.
They do now.
There's a book coming, but don't worry.
No, I didn't know.
Sorry, it's all good.
Actually, it's my show, so excited.
Okay. Well, for more info on that, see me or see these ladies.
So you have the promo code. If not, I will give that to you.
Excellent.
Would like to use it.
Coming to your inbox soon, so please sign up on meetup.com/highandy to stay in the loop. There's also a bunch of parties happening on 4:20, one of which is the Canna-Free NYC party at Space Ibiza. There's a bunch of underground events, I've heard, but I can't tell you about that today. There's a great event in Philadelphia at the end of the month. We've also got a promo code on that. Just look out in your emails for more info. Cool? Wow, you guys are really making it tough for me today. Come on, work with me. I can't stay mad at you guys. We had a quick announcement from a local activist and businessman who helps connect patients to doctors. I know we got a bunch of doctors in the room, but where's Steve? Steve,
right there.
Why don't you come on up real quick and tell the community about the work you've been doing.
Thank you, Michael.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone.
Steve, use the mic.
Thank you. So my name is Steven Rosinski, and I do have a company that helps people find doctors who are registered in New York to recommend medical cannabis. There is a need for this service because it's very hard to find a doctor otherwise. Thank you. I have much experience with the law. I was up in Albany a couple years ago, so I'm a bit of an expert in the area. If you have any questions, please come to me after. Speak to me. The service is free for people. I'm here to help you, so come talk to me, and I'll answer any questions you have.
That's
really, that's it.
Thanks, Steve.
Did you guys hear the good news?
Nope.
Philadelphia?
Oh, we did have
medical.
Yeah. 21st state now?
Yeah.
Wow. All right.
Wow.
Since you guys are a little antsy today and you're not here to see me or hear me talk, I'm just going to get right into it with our first speaker today. Alain Bankier is the former CEO of Manischewitz, which is an international kosher food brand. He is a member of the ArcView Investor Group. He is the founding partner of New York Angels, which is one of New York's largest tech angel investment communities. And he'll be speaking to us today about angel investment in cannabis and answering your questions as well. So please give Alain a big welcome to Hiring.
Give this community right now.
On behalf of High and Why,
it's a wonderful,
one of a kind. One of a kind.
Wonderful.
Show it to everybody.
I will.
Thank you, Michael, for having me. I'm still old school, so I write things on paper, and I need the paper. Can you hear me? Is that good?
Yeah.
Good. So, first of all, before I start, who is an entrepreneur in the room? Very good. And who is an investor in the room? Okay. You can have a fruitful dialogue. So my background very quickly is I started life as a securities analyst and then became an investment banker and an early stage investor through New York Angels, which I'm sorry to say is very not pro-cannabis friendly, but that's another story.
Yeah.
And after that, I started investing in companies and ended up with a company called Manischewitz, which is a kosher food manufacturer. And I sold that in 2013. To bank. And after that, I started thinking about what I wanted to do, and I bumped into a friend of mine who was a friend from Wall Street, and he was getting heavily involved in the cannabis industry. And I hadn't really been following what was going on in the cannabis industry. I was very cannabis friendly, I'm familiar with the product and have been consistently. And I said, wow, maybe I should look into that. And my first thought was basically to do edibles because I had a strong food background and I thought I would do that. So I went to California, I went to Colorado, and I discovered that I really didn't like the edibles industry, but I discovered the whole medical cannabis industry and the whole adult recreation industry, and it was absolutely phenomenal. And so I started looking at it and I started investing, and I've invested in quite a few companies in cultivation, in dispensaries, in processing, in tech, in an incubator, in, don't remember all of them now, but I've been at it for quite a while and I noticed quite a few interesting things. The first thing is that this is an industry that is attracting entrepreneurs that come from a whole bunch of other industries because it's a very young industry. And it's also attracting investors that come from all kinds of other industries because there's not a lot of history of investing in cannabis. And this is creating a little bit of a mess in the investment community, because the cannabis industry does not have a specific investment model that is basically consistent with the risk and reward that the cannabis industry presents. In every other industry, there's risk, there's rewards, and the way the structure of investment is set up is consistent with those risks and rewards. And basically, entrepreneurs have to figure out what they have to give away to get the money they need, and investors have to figure out what they want to get paid to take those risks. So in the real estate industries, you have parameters like cap rates and location. Private equity guys have multiples and leverage. The VC guys have pre-money, progress, exits. Oil, gas, movie industry has paybacks and profit sharing. But the cannabis industry doesn't have a consistent model, or even metrics, even comparables, even rules of thumb. So we certainly have a lot of risk. You know, without even talking about the obvious risk, like federal risk of the fact that it's investing is federally legal, the fact that there's tax issues and there's banking issues, there's other business issues. For example, we often talk about the cannabis industry and the cannabis market. There is no cannabis market. There are 24 separate markets that are all independent and have to be addressed independently. There's also, you know, last month, there were a couple of people here talking about brands and cannabis brands. Very hard to build a brand in the cannabis industry because you can't apply a lot of the rules that exist in marketing, because you can't market in a lot of the channels that you would normally market, and the distribution channels are very limited also. So the worst part of it all is that there's no clear vision for an exit. When people invest in companies, they want basically to have that wonderful day where they sell the company and everybody gets a big pot of gold. Well, in the cannabis industry, people are talking about, you know, prohibition ending by 2020 or whatever year you want. My view is that it's going to be messy, it's going to be political, and I don't know when it's going to happen. So taking together all those different constraints, there is one thing, though, that we have that's going for us, which is absolutely unique, is there is a $50 billion illegal market. And our challenge is to take that illegal market and make it a legal market. And that's something that's like pretty unique. That doesn't happen very often. When I started investing in tech, investing in the early 90s, we used to have conversations whether are people going to understand what www.something.com means? Are they going to know what to do with that? Are they going to know how to open a browser? And those were valid questions then. You may not think that those were valid questions, but they are. Today, when people hear the words weed, marijuana, THC, CBD, they know what to do with it. It's not very complicated. So the model that I have been structuring and that I've been investing in and implementing with quite a few entrepreneurs and other investors is basically a cash flow-based model, where the entrepreneur starts a company, the investors come and invest in the company to help build it, and then after the company starts generating cash flow, whether it be a year, whether it be a couple years, the money, the positive cash flow, and positive cash flow is what's left after you pay off all of your expenses, it's the profit that's left, that gets distributed to the investors until they get paid off. After that, the money is split between the entrepreneurs, the management, and the investors. So it's a pretty straightforward system, but what's unique in this situation also is that you're still building a business. You're still building a valuable asset that one day, whenever things start getting a little clearer and there are these exit opportunities, you can still have something that you can sell. So it's a pretty interesting situation. But in other words, through this cash flow model, you are paying the shareholders, the investors, to be patient. You're paying them to wait until that magic day. So this model is starting to evolve. It'll get fine-tuned. There's a lot of questions. It doesn't necessarily apply to everything. It doesn't apply to science-intensive or research-intensive businesses, but it'll start coming more and more together and start making sense. Now, although the industry is still evolving and needs to find its own model, there's some things that are still very, very consistent with investing in any business. And actually, they're even more important in this business. Often you'll talk to a VC or an investor and they'll say, what's the most important thing when you look at a deal? And they'll say, the management, the founders, the entrepreneurs, the management. In this industry, it's even much more important because it is key. People in this industry that come to this industry have to figure things out that nobody has figured out before. There's no plan, there's no chart ahead of them to tell them how things are done. So in this industry, management is absolutely crucial. The next thing that's super crucial in this industry, even more than any others, which is the word that you've often heard, due diligence, which is just a fancy word for saying figure out what you're looking at. And how do you do that? You go wherever you're investing. You dig down. You basically talk to attorneys. You talk to other people. You join angel groups. You join ArcView. You talk to other people in the industry to really try to figure out what's going on, because there's no other way to do it. There's no way to just sort of like magically figure it out. So a couple words for investors. The one thing that I would advise any investor looking at this industry, besides the making sure that they're betting on the right entrepreneur and due diligence, is to avoid FOMO. FOMO is fear of missing out. In this industry, there's so many people that get all excited when they hear something, and they tend to lose track that you know, the business sounds great, but it's a business plan, it's paper, it's a concept, and people get all riled up, and there will always be another great opportunity. So don't get tracked down into FOMO, which is fear of missing out on this opportunity. For the entrepreneurs, the best advice I can give is don't be greedy. Entrepreneurs are always very reluctant to give out their equity, to give out their cash flow, to give to investors. But what happens when you do that is you tend to attract what is often called in the VC industry dumb money. And you're probably thinking as an entrepreneur, well, money is money, you know, I'm going to take it no matter what. The thing is that down the road, once your business starts growing and once you start having issues and problems, the best people that you're going to be able to rely on for advice and for input and actually for more money is your investors. So choose very carefully. And the last thing is that in this industry, you have to also be careful who are your investors. Because this is not an industry that has a long track record. And there are a lot of seedy people out there that are investing, whether it's a public company or a private company, and you really need to understand who your investors are, because if you don't today, and there's a problem down the road, you'll wish you had.
These folks need no introduction, but I'm gonna do it anyway.
Yeah.
Woo!
Dr. Sue Sicily. You guys know her, okay.
Yeah.
Dr. Sicily has been pioneering PTSD research and cannabis research for a number of years. She's been working with lots and lots of veterans and other patients and has been featured in just about every media channel that you probably could ever hear of. So we're honored to have you join us today. Woo. Dr. Julie Holland. You guys are awake now, I love it. She's a New Yorker, local,
yeah.
Love that. Worked at Bellevue in the psych yard. Fun stuff there. Kind of like this crowd, I bet. best-selling author of Midnight's at Bellevue?
Weekends
at Bellevue, Moody Bitches. The Pop Book.
The Pop Book. And for you old timers, Ecstasy the Complete Guide.
Yeah. Ecstasy the Complete Guide.
That was a good read.
Awesome. Dr. David Nathan is
woo!
Distinguished doctor, also kind of, well, New Jersey is local enough,
close
enough, magna cum laude from Princeton University, sharp guy, and you'll learn a lot more about what he's doing in the industry shortly, but I'll let him tell it. And then Brian, last name I cannot say.
Me neither.
Brian is the, what he does will be very clear to you soon, but I'll let him tell it.
All right.
Everybody, as Michael introduced me, my name is David Nathan. I'm a country doctor from Princeton, New Jersey, and I am a psychiatrist. I'm a writer, and I'm an educator. And by way of background, I have written on a variety of subjects, and at some point was sufficiently incensed with our war on marijuana that I wrote an article that wound up in the Wall Street Journal. Thinking that I was just adding my voice to the many physicians who have spoken up on this issue, because most of the doctors that I knew were very pro-legalization, talking about what a silly thing it was for this particular drug to be against the law. And I should say that you know, we're right now making a big transition from our last speaker to us. We're not entrepreneurs, we're not investors, maybe some of us are. And what we are is physicians. And as physicians, we have a responsibility for public health. And as citizens, we have an obligation for social justice. And it is in that context that we are here today, on the day that earlier we had a press conference that launched an organization that I'm going to talk to you about in just a minute. Does anybody know who this is on the screen? William C. Woodward, a physician and an attorney. And he was, in 1937, days that may mean something to a lot of people here, he was the legal counsel for the American Medical Association. And in that context, he gave testimony at the Marijuana Tax Act hearings. And here, for those of you who can see, this is what one of many brilliant and prescient things that Dr. Woodward said on that day, May 4th, 1937. I'll just read it to you. The federal government would meet with the same difficulty with this particular bill that it met in prosecuting under the National Prohibition Act, the inadequacy of the courts, the inadequacy of prosecuting attorneys, and, I may say, the inadequacy of jails. And so imagine, this is 1937, May 4th, if we were to change the date to today,
be the same thing.
Change two words out of this document, from would meet who has met, and this is a true statement today, and this is what we're faced with in the United States. And so who's saying this today among the medical community? Well, the answer is Doctors for Cannabis Regulation. Yeah. And so here we are, and we are a group of over 50 physicians, many of whom are, well, all of whom have some degree of prominence around the country. We come from 15 or 16 states, plus the District of Columbia. We represent states of nearly half of the population of the United States already. And all of us have signed on to a document that you guys will be able to find on our website starting today. And that document we have called the Declaration of Principles. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but but I will read just a couple of highlights. We, the Board of Directors, the Honorary Board, and founding physician members of Doctors for Cannabis Regulation, with firm reliance on science and reason, hereby endorse this Declaration of Principles. We believe cannabis prohibition is harmful, and we give lots of evidence how and why. We believe that cannabis prohibition is ineffective, and more evidence. We believe that cannabis prohibition is unnecessary, and we therefore support cannabis legalization for adults, preventive education of minors, and yes, regulation of the industry. We call upon physicians and medical associations to promote cannabis regulation as an alternative to prohibition. Once supplied with the evidence, even physicians who vigorously oppose cannabis use may logically advocate for its legalization for adults. With confidence in the judgment of history, we commit our names to the support of this declaration, published on the 18th day of April, 2016. Thank you. And so, of course, it was 1937 when cannabis was made illegal. And it was also at that point that its name was semi-officially changed to marijuana. And so what has happened for us 78, actually going on 79 years now, but we'll say 78, hasn't been that long. 700,000 arrests in the United States every year for marijuana possession. African Americans are nearly four times more likely to be arrested for marijuana-related infractions. And an arrest record, what does it do? It contributes to the problems facing the folks in our nation of lower socioeconomic status. And you can read the rest. We want to move things along. Why are we talking about this now? What is different now? And you can see it in this graph. And I should tell you that the General Social Survey and the numbers you see here is pretty much the most conservative estimate of the public opinion on the issue of marijuana legalization. And what you see is that a majority of Americans now favor legalization, but it's still against the law. Now, where do physicians stand? Well, attitudes among physicians are changing as well. And what you see is that physicians with any level of familiarity with marijuana use, any physician who has tried cannabis even once in his or her life has a 60% chance of favoring legalization. And I should note that those physicians who have never tried it, and yes, there are many out there, they still are quite split on this issue, but yet quite a few of them favor some degree of legalization. And so what we know is that a majority of American physicians favor some kind of legalization for marijuana. And we also know that hundreds of thousands of physicians in America now favor full legalization of cannabis. And we ask those physicians to join us. And that's why we're here today. That's why we appreciate you giving us this forum to talk about this issue. I'd say good morning. And physicians have been increasingly willing to state their pro-legalization position. There is certainly a reason for doctors, if you will, staying in the closet, and that would be the potential for sounding like they're pro-drug. And yet the reality is that you don't have to be pro-marijuana to oppose its legalization. And that's what physicians are realizing today. There has been no national organization to represent doctors like us, which really surprised me. I spent about 2 months in late 2014 researching what was the organization that was going to help doctors who favored this political position. And much to my surprise, there was none. And that was the kernel for the idea of bringing the group of physicians together and you can read about all of us on the Declaration. Respected physicians, mainstream physicians, physicians who have been given fellowships by medical societies, physicians who are professors, they are the chairs of their departments at major medical schools. And there has been a vacant seat at the table whenever there is a discussion of legalization. Who sits in for the doctors? There's been no one. But today, Doctors for Cannabis Regulation is filling that empty seat. And I think it's time for my colleague. Shall we go to the next slide? Our mission statement. In the interest of time, I will probably not read the whole thing. Now, what the heck, you want to hear it?
Yes.
Doctors for Cannabis Regulation serves as a voice for physicians who believe that cannabis prohibition has failed and that the misuse of cannabis should be treated as a medical, or actually we changed that one word to health issue, rather than a criminal one. DFCR's physician members strive to neither minimize nor to exaggerate the actual risks and benefits of cannabis use in the scientific literature that relates to that. DFCR promotes evidence-based strategies to prevent recreational marijuana use by minors and to help with misuse by adults. Through public education and support for changes in U.S. law, the DFCR advocates for the legalization, taxation, and above all, effective regulation of cannabis in the United States. What regulation are we talking about? We don't really have time, unfortunately, today to get into everything, but these are no-brainers here. Some of these ideas here, government oversight of cannabis production, testing, distribution, and sales, labeling that will allow for informed consumers, something that we don't have under a system of prohibition, and really focusing our attention on those for whom the personal use of cannabis can be dangerous, that being those underage. And if we want kids to believe us when we say that marijuana use could be harmful for them, then we better create a legal distinction between adults and minors. Because in the system that we have now, where marijuana is illegal for everyone, kids don't listen to us. They don't believe us that it could be harmful to them, because they know we're not telling the truth about adults. Some doctors may not admit to that, but kids know it. And so we need to create that legal distinction between those adults, consenting adults, for whom the use of a non-lethal drug should never have been prohibited in the first place, and underage use. Now I'd like to introduce our executive director, Brian Murarescu. I can say his name for a long time. You may know Rick Doblin. He is actually the gentleman who connected us with Brian, who, as a good Samaritan and a distinguished attorney trained at Brown and Georgetown Law, wanted to help out in this effort. And so he was referred to us. We took him on as our counsel, quickly realized how brilliant this guy was. And so we had him join our board. And after he took a look at what exactly we were doing and how we were doing it, he decided to leave his job and to become our executive director, and has brought us to the point where we are now. He's going to tell you a little bit about the structure of Doctors for Cannabis Regulation. Please join me in welcoming Brian Morris.
Beginning to regret that decision every day.
No.
So I called Rick Doblin last year and said, listen, I'm really interested in what's happening in this country. It seems like one of the greatest social experiments of our time. And he said, there's a bunch of doctors trying to form this organization. And I said, well, they probably need some help. So I offered some pro bono services, and then a few months later found myself on the board, and then was so compelled by everything that I heard on conference calls from Sue and Julie and everybody else you're going to meet soon that I decided to pack it up and join them. So we have an actual organization now. A bit more about it. We exist legally. We've been incorporated. We have all kinds of great corporate governance mechanisms, if that interests you. I'm guessing it doesn't, so we'll go quickly through this. We have a board of directors. Four of them stand before you now. They are some of the most prominent physicians from all around the country. I'm not an MD or a doctor, and even I recognize their names. On the board, we have the executive committee is comprised of our president, who's sitting here, the secretary Darby, and the treasurer Sunil, who can't be with us. Malik Burnett, some of you may have heard of his name. Julie, obviously, and Sue, and Udi, who's the head of the ACLU in New Jersey. We also have on the honorary board some real talent and caliber who brings a lot of legitimacy to what we've been trying to do. We were on a national teleconference with them earlier today. Folks like the former Surgeon General Jocelyn Elders joined our organization early on. This is all before going public, by the way. This is before any press or any PR. They had no idea who we were or what we were trying to achieve. We have the former head of CSAT, the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment, Dr. Wesley Clark. Chris Beyerer, president of the International AIDS Society at Hopkins, Don Abrams out in San Francisco, Lester Grinspoon of Harvard. A lot of you probably know Carl Hart, uptown in Columbia, Dr. David Lewis at my alma mater in Brown, Andy Weil, you've probably heard of, the pioneer of integrative medicine. That's me, the one of two staff people at the moment. It's kind of a one or two person operation. But that said, I mean, the board does everything pro bono, basically. They find time to do this amidst all their other, you know, very busy projects for which I'm very grateful. But it's difficult going at the moment, so bear with us. Laura Barrett's our webmaster who prevents the site from going down and things like that. She's around that. She's in the back, Laura. And we'll hire more people as we gather momentum. David talked about the Declaration of Principles, obviously. Physicians from all around the country. I think one's actually, at least one is with us today. Dr. Grace Ford is joining us. Founding physician member. There will be more to come. So we're going public today. It's, you know, to become a member in DFCR is free for physicians and, you know, allied health professionals. It's absolutely free to join. So please go on our website. It's dfcr.org and check it out. You can get in touch with us that way. If you're not a physician like myself, you're still welcome to join. We just ask for a modest donation, something as little as $25 of support. But we're happy to have everybody. We want to engage the public. As a matter of fact, and like I mentioned, everything is available on our website. You can skip along here. This is the basic levels of support that we're asking for. Again, it can be as humble as $25, or it can be as non-humble as the bottom figure you see there. but you can go to our website and see everything. So we're essentially we're an organization that wants to educate. That wants to obviously attract physicians that we can recruit to help get the message out there. We make ourselves available to the media for op-eds and interviews and all kinds of media appearances. I'm based in Washington, D.C., obviously, so we want to address this issue both at the federal and state level. We'll be talking to lawmakers and we'll be talking to legislators all around the country and trying to move the conversation forward. So you can help by donating, you can help by reaching out to your doctor friends, and you can help by connecting them to us, and going on our website and getting in touch with us and giving me a call anytime you're bored. That's it.
Excellent.
With that over, I mean, obviously, I'm going to pass it to Julie and Sue to entertain you.
Watch the game. All right. was so excited because after that big Washington Post article on Friday, our website crashed, which I thought was awesome that we were so popular with that much traffic. So definitely go visit it. The website's back up now. I want to also acknowledge we have Dr. Jim Stoll. Where did he go? He's a spine surgeon from Milwaukee. He was our very first donor to DFCR. We're so grateful. Awesome. I just want to mention one thing, and then I'm going to let Julie talk. I brought these dog tags because the veterans asked me to distribute these here. The veterans at a nonprofit called 22 Hope created these dog tags with the number 22 engraved in them to highlight the epidemic of veteran suicide in the country. And that's part of what motivated me to jump on board with this group, was because I see the big untold story in these 23, now 24 medical cannabis states is that hardly any veterans enter this program around the country because they can't get a VA doctor to certify them. And so one of the things that we are determined to do is end this situation where physicians are forced to be gatekeepers for these programs and simply advocate for full legalization and stop this absurd situation where veterans are prevented from having safe legal access to lab-tested cannabis. So I would say if any of you want these dog tags, we're giving them away, and I have a ton more that we're going to be around all week at the UNGAS meetings around the UN. So if any of you want to grab these and show your support for the veterans community. But I think that, you know, hopefully today our launch of this organization is will begin the process where common sense and science will finally prevail over this absurd drug war. Thank you all.
Hi, my name is Julie Holland. I'm a psychiatrist in New York City, and on behalf of the state legislature, I would like to apologize for our crappy medical cannabis law. It's terrible. It's an insult to this plant, this law. People are trying to change it, and we're all complaining, but it's pretty slow. It's terrible to go up to Albany and see how the sausage is made and talk to these people. It's pretty demoralizing. So I appreciate anyone who keeps doing it, because I can stomach it. I try to keep up. So I am also involved in cannabis research with treating post-traumatic stress disorder with various strains of cannabis. And I'm trying to do my part in being a good doctor in New York. And I'm a harm reductionist. So to me, the big issue is that sort of the worst thing that can happen to many of us if we use cannabis is that we end up in the criminal justice system. And that ends up being really one of the biggest risks and harms of the drug, and out of proportion to the effects of the drug. This is an ancient medicinal plant that's been used for thousands of years, that's only been illegal for 70, 80 years for primarily racist reasons. I mean, it's a combination of corporate greed and racism, and we should all sing God Bless America now, because that's what makes us great. Corporate greed and racism. So, I mean, that, unfortunately, is sort of the basis of our drug policy right now. It's not medicine, it's not science, it's not logic, and I really see my husband used the word hypocrisy gap, which I kind of like. You know, this idea that, first of all, you know, the United States has a patent out on using cannabis as a neuroprotectant.
Yeah.
And yet, it's a Schedule I drug, which means there's no accepted medical use and high potential for abuse. And yet, pure synthetic THC, which will get you very banged up, is a Schedule III that I could, like, until recently, literally phone in a prescription. You know, there's a gross inadequacy to the way that we schedule drugs in this country. And, you know, we would like to see cannabis descheduled. By the way, if you're interested... We could put cigarettes and alcohol on Schedule I and see how that goes. But this idea that there are some drugs that are not scheduled and some, I mean, it is so inappropriately scheduled on Schedule 1. Even my 12-year-old can see that it doesn't make sense. So, if anyone is a tweeter, if you're a Twitter person, the hashtag is doctors say legalize. Doctors, plural, say legalize. I think, are we doing Q&A or no? That's kind of my favorite thing.
So, thank you for coming. This question is for anybody who does research with cannabis. Anybody who prospectively administers cannabis to patients. As an advocate, one of the arguments that we constantly hear, we hear this from politicians in every state legislature and at the federal level, is that we can't liberalize marijuana laws, we can't regulate cannabis until it's vetted through the FDA system.
Correct.
And you refer to some kind of FDA-type studies. I assume you're talking about phase 3 studies. And I'm wondering, is this completely disingenuous? Is it possible? How would somebody get the study drug if they wanted to do a phase 3 type study?
Sure. He's asking is the claims of elected officials saying that we can't legalize until we do these studies, is this real? That can the studies actually be done? Can it be put through the FDA process? We are determined to prove that we can put whole plant cannabis through the FDA drug development process, and our study is the first step to doing that. So our PTSD study that many of the good people in this room have been following, we really appreciate all of the incredible support you've given us over the last 6 years. But just to remind everybody, we submitted the study design to the FDA in 2010. We got approval quickly. I mean, the FDA, you know, worked collaboratively with us. They were not the blockade. So the FDA are physician investigators. They want to see whole plant marijuana put through their drug development process. But the impediments are the layers of government red tape that occur after the FDA approval. So even though we obtained FDA approval in early 2011, here we are over 5 years later, still unable to screen or, you know, still unable to implement the study and screen our first veteran into the study. So that shows you that it's not the FDA, but it is possible. Our study will take 2 years to conduct. And after that, if the data is compelling, the FDA may allow us to go to phase 3 at that point. And after, you know, phase 3 will probably take 3 years. So it's possible that within 5 years, if the data is impressive and statistically significant, we could persuade the FDA to give whole plant cannabis an FDA indication to be on the market for PTSD in this case. And so that would be a gigantic breakthrough for the industry, for the movement in general, because suddenly insurance companies would be forced to provide whole plant cannabis on the market. You know, they'd have to put it on their formulary and have to provide some subsidy, and that would be an incredible gift because, as we know, our patients now, it's very difficult for sick and debilitated patients to pay for cannabis. I was on a panel at the summit this week, the NYU summit, with Alice Mead. Many of you know her from GW Pharmaceuticals. And we talked about the distinction that, yes, we want her products on the market, and we also want whole plant cannabis as an option. Patients need access to options. And it's important that both of those be available, legally lab-tested, FDA-approved, available. But the point is that whole plant cannabis is going to be much more economical for patients. It's going to be much more economical for insurance companies than the GW product, which we all know is going to come out on the market at a ridiculously high price. So with bottom line, patients need access to options. We are determined to get cannabis through the entire FDA drug development process, and it's not a fantasy. You know, it is a real potential that we can do that.
So, I mean, focusing on your question of is it disingenuous, I would say absolutely it is disingenuous, because what, first of all, you could prescribe THC that's Schedule 3, so that's gone through an FDA approval process. Then you have Sativex, the Vixamols, which is an extract of a whole plant, which FDA has got an awful lot of data on double-blind studies. And then you have data from Spain, you have data from Israel. There's plenty of data, you know, but what our government says is, you know, but but there's no, you know, double-blind studies that have happened here in America, and that's what we need. But they're not allowing those studies to happen. So there's a total catch-22 that, you know, it can't be rescheduled or descheduled because they don't have the data, but they won't allow the data to be generated because they've got a monopoly on this very lousy grade cannabis. The research grade cannabis in America is only provided by one farm, and if you're a patient and if you're grandfathered in and you get pot from the government, you get a mixture of stems and seeds and flowers all ground up that like any, you know, high schooler would turn their nose at. So America is making it very difficult to generate the data that would allow it to be FDA approved. So it is disingenuous.
And as the non-researcher in this group, I would like to emphasize for the physicians out there, and I know most of you are not physicians, but the physicians who hopefully will hear this, to those physicians I say, even if you don't understand the mechanism of action of cannabis and all of its derivatives, even if you know something about this and you think that for whatever reason, personal or otherwise, that it's not a good habit for adults, even if you are against the use of cannabis, think about the cost of prohibition. Think about the public health disaster that we have with marijuana prohibition. And then think about the degree to which you've seen actual harm to your patients from this plan. And you know, I've talked to physicians in states where it's been legalized, and I haven't said anything about my position. I think now maybe somewhat apparent to some. But when I've talked to people not saying anything about my personal feelings, I'll ask them, Colorado, so how's it going to an emergency room doctor? How's it going out there now with cannabis having been legalized? And usually I get a sarcastic remark like, oh, they're just, the bodies are piling up. And it's blood in the streets. And it's a complete disaster we can't keep up with everything. And you're all chuckling, why? Because that's absurd. And what they're saying to me is, come on, let's be serious. We know what we're talking about here. We're talking about marijuana. We're not talking about, you know, some very, I heard heroin out there. It's a different drug. And I think physicians need to do their homework and understand that distinction if they don't understand it already. To do otherwise, and to do otherwise is doing a disservice to your patients, and it's doing a disservice to your profession, it's doing a disservice to medical ethics, it's doing a disservice to this country.
Somebody mentioned heroin. I just want to point out, if New York State would add a few indications for people to be able to join the program, like post-traumatic stress disorder, like chronic pain, we obviously have a huge opioid epidemic in this country. And medicinal cannabis or recreational cannabis can be used as a way to lower your dosage of your opiate pain meds or to get off your opiate pain meds entirely. And I certainly personally know that. Is a good pain reliever because it works better on neuropathic pain than opiates do, because it is an anti-inflammatory medicine. It's a good choice for people with arthritis, for people with serious pain, with people who have neuropathic pain, with HIV, with diabetes. Lisa.
Lisa, Eileen, let's do a question. And then we have to wrap it up, and I'm sorry about
it. So you guys are going to be on gas. Are you going to list on your website where you're going to be so that people like us can come and support you?
Sure.
Okay, good.
DFCR.org. Eileen?
Have you actually received federal cannabis for your studies yet? Have you been given the go-ahead yet?
No.
That's the only thing we're waiting on is the
DEA Schedule 1 license is required in order to purchase cannabis from the University of Mississippi.
And that's what's, you know, this is the way that the government can delay the process. Everyone wonders, how did they possibly delay this 6 years? They can just leave a report that was submitted to them last year on their desk, which is what they've done for so many months. And though we've had many, many people, elected officials, call the DEA office and ask them, what's the status of the report? It's, you know, it's impossible to do a study when you've got, you can't even, I can't even rent a facility because I'm so scared I'm gonna end up paying, you know, wasting tons of money on rent. It's really, it's a huge problem because the issue is none of these government agencies that are involved in the approval process have any timeline. That's why it was such a joy to work with the FDA because they're on a 30-day timetable. But these other agencies, DEA, can take as long as they want and they benefit from the delays. They can, and obviously they don't want any data that might legitimize cannabis as medicine. So the longer they can suppress this and stonewall it, the longer they can delay the inevitable, which we all know is that the legalization of this plant. So I'm sad to say that, you know, this has made me very cynical about the guy. When we started this process in 2010, I assumed that we'd be underway within a year or two, and I'm stunned at how this has been systematically impeded by the government. And Julie's right, I mean, we have thousands of controlled trials already published in peer-reviewed medical journals confirming the therapeutic benefits of this plant. And so anyone, any elected official who tells you there's not sufficient scientific, yeah, it doesn't rise to the level of randomized controlled trials all the time, but there are many really exquisitely designed studies that make an excellent argument, and I can help you. If you're looking for data, we can certainly help you organize.
And if nothing else, can't we let our nation's veterans, adults, make from Uruguay, and many or most of you probably know that Uruguay was the first nation to fully legalize cannabis in the world. And I would ask, and you were talking about individuals' rights to self-determination. Yeah. And my question to you is, as a physician in Uruguay, have you seen a problem with the legalization of cannabis? Was just pointing out that in Puerto Rico, it is no longer Schedule 1. it's Schedule 2.
Yeah, start. Everyone, I'm so grateful for your questions and enthusiasm, but unfortunately,
Michael,
we're out of time.
Let Alan ask his question.
Yeah, I do want to. Alan, you sure? Yeah. Ask it, Alan.
In New York
State,
what are the problems?
Not enough physicians are signing up. I've spoken to a lot of friends of mine, and they have had, they've been worried about repercussions that they might have because they're part of a larger organization,
right,
whether it's Cornell, Mount Sinai, and NYU
Langone.
What are you going to be able to do, if anything, about that? I mean, who have you dialogue with about that?
Well, first of all, I have definitely heard, you know, through the grapevine, because I was on the faculty at NYU for years. I'm not anymore, but I've heard that they are unofficially encouraging doctors not to sign up. No, I don't think, if anybody can bring me any evidence of like a memo or anything, to me this is really like a civil rights issue. You know, we should be allowed to, I mean, I should be allowed to recommend to my patients what I think is best for me. If I have a patient who I think would benefit from cannabis and, you know, they don't meet the criteria, which is ridiculously strict, and also there's no flower, I say something to them like, well, do you know any kids? You know, because a kid could get you pot, you know, because they're like, well, I don't know where to get it and I don't want to break the law. I mean, like, I have to ask my patients if they know any kids. It's absurd. So there's a group of lawyers who are meeting called Cannabar, and we're really looking at whether the rights of the doctors are being infringed. Like, I'm a psychiatrist. I want to be able to prescribe cannabis for my patients who have post-traumatic stress disorder, for my female patients who have cramps, for people who have insomnia, for people who have anxiety. I mean, I would like to experiment with using CBD and a negative symptom schizophrenic. There's a lot of things that I would like to do as a physician. My hands are tied, and that seems to me that it's not just impinging on patients' rights, it's impinging on my rights to practice.
Yeah. And I know Michael needs us to end, but I wanted to end with a story. And this is a story that I've been given permission to tell. And that story is of the one patient that I, as a physician in New Jersey, have registered and recommended cannabis to in a legal way. I have a lot of patients who don't qualify for it. And as a psychiatrist, there are no psychiatric indications in the state of New Jersey.
Or New York.
Yep. And however, and I read the law very carefully. I didn't expect to be a recommending physician at any point. I hadn't registered for the program. But I got a patient who I was seeing for about a year. As he slowly lost weight from a non-smoking related lung cancer. And this guy was suffering. He was nauseated. He couldn't eat. He was losing weight. He was in pain from bone metastases. What are the other reasons that somebody, I mean, it was the pain, it was the nausea, the wasting, the lack of appetite. And I talked to his oncologist, who wasn't comfortable recommending cannabis, but did give the okay for me to do so if I was comfortable doing so. So I registered, having had an established relationship with this guy, after a lot of back and forth with the state where they didn't want to tell me whether or not it was okay, they finally gave me something that sounded like an okay. I registered him. He went to one of just a few dispensaries that was available in New Jersey. He was very weak by that time. But his wife took him. It was an older couple. And they got him a vaporizer, which is what I recommended. And with the guy having lung tumors, it was about the only way he was going to be able to consume it. And he was only able to really inhale it once without having choking and coughing fits. And there were no edibles because they are not legal in the state of New Jersey. And that was the decision of our Governor Christie. And so I then did something that may well have been illegal. If the prosecutors out there are listening, feel free to prosecute me for this one. And that was that I recommended to his wife, because by that time he was mostly taken to bed. I recommended to his wife that she try to make an edible out of what she was given from this dispensary. And I'm not sure whether that's legal, but I did it because it was moral and it was ethical. I will tell you that I gave her all the instructions. It took me a while to figure it out because I've never done anything like that. To figure it out, and I got instructions that she could follow. Nice Italian mom, she could do the cooking thing. But you know what? He had 2 weeks to live, he needed her help, and she was never able to do that for him. And I told you that there was one time he was able to inhale it well enough, he felt better, he was able to sleep, that was the other thing he couldn't do. He slept, he ate, he wasn't nauseated. But this guy died with nausea, with pain, with insomnia, and having lost a tremendous amount of weight. And I would challenge Governor Christie to account for that kind of outcome, that any politician who has opposed legalization or medical marijuana, they are responsible for the suffering that still occurs today and that occurred for this family. That I had the good fortune to have met. So thank you very much.
Don't assume it's in the bag, right? Everybody feels like cannabis legalization in America is inevitable. They're beginning to think marijuana is just gonna legalize itself. The people looking to make money in this are just counting on all the activists to just keep doing what they're doing without thinking where the money is coming from to make that happen. And the activists sometimes are getting so overconfident that they think we can win anything.